Oh, thank you very much for that introduction of my background. I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very happy in particular to see my former colleagues who have been dealing with water in many years. I should mention I miss the presence of Soroji Nazi, former director of water at UNESCO headquarters. Then he moved to the Water Institute in the Netherlands. And I met him at an international conference a couple of years ago, but nevertheless, I wasn't able to visit the Netherlands at his invitation to visit the Institute, which I also created as what we call, what UNESCO calls Category 1 Institute, as a proposal of the Dutch government. But at any rate, I repeat once again, I'm very, very happy to be here on the occasion of the 50th anniversary of IHP. And I'm very happy also to be in Kyoto, in particular at Kyoto University. I come to Kyoto very often these days, but mostly in conjunction with cultural heritage issues, Kyoto being one of the richest, perhaps the richest city of Japan in the area of cultural heritage. But having said that, I'd like to come back to your main concern, namely water. I clearly remember, I visited Kyoto back in 2003. Unfortunately, before you started working for UNESCO in the area of water, it was to attend the third World Water Forum organized by UNESCO in cooperation with the Japanese government in order to present the first UN water report, which UNESCO initiated. And in the presence of Japan's Crown Prince and Crown Princess. It was in March 2003. And looking back, it was a very, very memorable visit, and also very important occasion for UNESCO to indicate to the world the importance of water issues, and also the important role UNESCO has been playing or has started to play in the area of fresh water in collaboration with other UN agencies. Perhaps I should reflect on a couple of concrete things, and I must confess I left UNESCO more than 5 years ago, but nevertheless, I came back to Japan with a lot of boxes, with a lot of documents, a lot of publications, which stay in a warehouse far away from my apartment where I live in Tokyo. And when I was asked to give a speech, I intended to go to the warehouse to check these boxes, but I didn't have time to do. Therefore, I must confess at the very beginning, what I will say is more or less based on my memory. If there are factual errors, I must ask you for your indulgence at the very beginning. But I would like to start by saying when I became the Director General of UNESCO, I said to my staff, all senior staff of the UNESCO Secretariat, there are five sectors at UNESCO, as you know: education, culture, natural science, social science, and communication. And definitely, UNESCO's budget was not unlimited. In particular, that was before the return of the United States, and This is another issue. Therefore, I don't like to elaborate on it. One of my targets was to bring back the United States to UNESCO, the country that left UNESCO in 84. Therefore, when I became the Director General of UNESCO in 1999, the United States was not there. Japan was therefore the biggest contributor to the UNESCO budget, paying 25%. 25% was the ceiling. My target was to bring back the United States. It was important to get United States involvement in all global issues. I said to my colleagues, it's almost unthinkable to discuss global issues and try to implement them without the participation of the biggest country in the world, the United States. But anyway, when I arrived, it was still before the United States come back to UNESCO. Therefore, budget was rather limited. Therefore, I argued first within the Secretariat, then vis-a-vis member states, that these five sectors should have top priority, one top priority in each sector. First I proposed within the Secretariat, talking to my senior staff, I would like to propose that the natural science sector should choose water, in particular fresh water, as the top priority of the sector. Luckily, UNESCO had already had very active IHP, and also UNESCO had very knowledgeable experts represented by Savaji Nadi. So I was able to depend on, but those who were not dealing with water within the natural science sector understandably opposed. They were afraid the programs which they were in charge of would get less priority, as a result less financial resources, less human resources. Of course, that was the expected result. But I wanted to give more financial resources, more human resources to the water division, or to water-related work more broadly. But anyway, being the Director General of UNESCO, vis-a-vis my colleagues within the Secretary, I insisted on my priority. And then my task was to persuade member states, in particular members of the executive board, which was not an easy task. But they nevertheless accepted, being the crucial importance of water in the coming world, in terms of quantity, but also in terms of quality. Therefore, I was very happy the member states, in particular executive board, accepted my priorities, including water for the natural science sector as UNESCO's new priorities. And I once again stress, I was very happy. We already had a very active committee, IHP, supported by strong staff of UNESCO, headed by Savoji Nadi. But nevertheless, that's not enough. That was my judgment. And talking to Savoji Nadi and others, I argued, UNESCO must first strengthen UNESCO's work on freshwater, surrounding around IHP, of course, but UNESCO must try to establish a stronger leadership within the UN family, because there are a number of other members of the UN family which deal with various aspects of water. Therefore, without establishing a UN-wide, cooperative system or collaboration mechanism, it would be very difficult for UNESCO to fulfill, its mandate, or it would be difficult to present to the world, United Nations, position or assessment of existing water problems, or United Nations, proposed solutions for these problems. And I was very really happy to discover a few months later, namely in March 2000, there would be the second World Water Forum. And I took the post of Director General, DG of UNESCO in November 1999. Therefore, only a few months later, but I asked Nojinaji to talk to other agencies' representatives, in particular in the context of UN Water, and to persuade them to establish a new UN-wide initiative led by UNESCO, but with the participation of all other UN agencies that deal with various aspects of water, in particular fresh water. And I said to Sarojinaji, I would like to make a proposal, but I would like to make such a proposal. I would like to announce such a new initiative for the UN system, representing not only UNESCO, but also representing the whole UN system at the coming meeting of the second water forum to be held in the Netherlands. He and his work staff worked very hard. I was very happy. He came back to me to tell me he now has got a broad basic agreement from his colleagues of other UN agencies. Therefore, I was able to announce a new initiative in March 2000, only 5 months after my arrival at UNESCO. New initiative led by UNESCO, but with the participation of more than 20 UN family members. The first product would be new UN-wide water report to be presented to the world in the next World Water Forum, namely in the third one, which was held indeed in Kyoto in March 2003. And Sarojinaji and my colleagues worked very hard in collaboration with others. Therefore, I was very happy to present the first water report produced by the UN-wide collaboration at the third World Water Forum held in here in Kyoto. In fact, I wanted to look at the first report, which I have in my warehouse, but as I said, I was not able to go back. So I still remember that report with a small child with big smile, with water coming, water pouring over the child's body. But anyway, it was a very, very a good report. And and I'm very happy the then Secretary General of UN, Mr. Kofi Annan, was very cooperative, very understanding, and very supportive of my initiative. Of course, I talked to him before the second water forum, where I would announce that initiative in order to get his understanding and his basic agreement. He was very supportive. He wasn't at the second World Forum, but he was very supportive. And this is another important international meeting UNESCO organized with in cooperation with other agencies, Education for All meeting in April 2000, held in Dakar, with the participation of Mr. Kofi Annan. So it was 1 month after the second Water Forum. I was very happy to tell him the second Water Forum went very well, and UNESCO's new initiative was very strongly applauded by the participants, and Mr. Kofi Annan was very happy to hear that input from me. Even though it was an entirely different topic, it was an education meeting. And also, you know, I asked Mr. Kofi Annan to let, you know, the UN Water Group continue, because, you know, at the time, you know, we, you know, heads of agencies met, you know, under the chairmanship of Mr. Kofi Annan twice a year. And, you know, Mr. Kofi Annan was the one, the first UN Secretary General to try to establish, you know, UN-wide collaboration, all important issues, including IMF and the World Bank. It was important that, you know, such UN-wide collaboration would be established, you know, under the leadership of the UN Secretary General, because many issues, including, you know, water issues, of course, are, you know, sort of, you know, interdisciplinary issues, which, you know, cannot be handled by one single UN agency. It must be handled by quite a few, sometimes by many. Therefore, Mr. Kofi Annan, before my arrival at UNESCO, took initiative establishing what is called, you know, CEB, Chief Executive Board, grouping, you know, more than 20, you know, UN agencies heads, and we met, you know, twice a year. But Mr. Kofi Annan also thought, you know, it's important to review these sectoral groups, including the UN Water Group. He somehow assumed these sectoral groups are not necessarily producing positive results. And also, based on his conviction that many issues are interdisciplinary, therefore, it's better to regroup them into one single body under CEB. It's a group of deputies of these UN agencies. And of course, you know, I supported his idea, his proposal, but I argue there must be exceptions, like, you know, UN Water Group. These sectoral issues are very important. Therefore, there must be, you know, an exception. One of them ought to be UN Water Group, which, you know, he also accepted. I was very, very thankful to him. Therefore, I repeat what I said. When I propose in the name of UNESCO or in the name of the UN family, a new initiative on fresh water in March 2000, I was able to assume that UN Water Group would continue being the important, you know, support group of that, you know, initiative. And I was also very happy that when Mr. Kofi Annan organized the UN summit in September 2000. Therefore, 6 months after the Second World Water Forum, UN summit, you know, to adopt the new Millennium Development Goals, abbreviated as MDGs. I think you are all familiar with the MDGs, you know. That was adopted at the summit in September 2000. And I, of course, attended, and I was very happy that in Goal 7, there is a sub-goal referring to water. If I may, I will read out how the sub-goal of Goal 7 of MDGs was awarded, reduced by half the proportion of people without sustainable access to safe drinking water. The other day, I did read in the Japanese press that somebody has prepared, has reviewed the status of implementation of MDGs. There are 8 goals, they, or UN, has published its review report. But reading Japanese press's summary of the review report, which focused on, of course, Goal 1, which refers to, you know, the eradication of extreme poverty and hunger, the most important goal of the MDGs, there was a fairly detailed, you know, assessment of how Goal 1, namely eradication of poverty and hunger, was, you know, implemented. But there was no particular reference to the water goal. I should have tried to get access to the report, which I'm sorry I didn't. But anyway, I was very happy that there was a sub-goal in the context of Goal 7 entitled Ensure Environmental Sustainability. So, therefore, no, looking back, you know, that, you know, sub-goal did strengthen UNESCO's new initiative. My initiative within UNESCO, and also UNESCO's new initiative, you know, for the whole UN family. Perhaps, you know, I should mention that, you know, though I assume, you know, you are all aware that now the UN final preparation for the adoption of a new development goals entitled SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals, has been underway, and the new SDGs will be adopted once again at the summit to be held at this time by Mr. Ban Ki-moon in New York in September of this year, and many president, many prime ministers will come, and I know that the Prime Minister of Japan, Mr. Abe, will go there. There are, as you know, 17 goals, therefore more than doubled, you know, compared to the MDG in terms of number. And there are also a number of, you know, sub-goals. Of course, you know, the basic, you know, or the most important goal is to, you know, eradicate, you know, extreme poverty and hunger as the MDGs, which came to an end in 2015, and the new SDGs and, target at 2030. Then I'm very happy that there is a new goal, Goal 6, which is totally devoted water. Of course, it is still a proposal, but my understanding is, you know, it is a proposal very carefully prepared by experts for several years. Therefore, it's not very likely, and it's almost certain that these 17 goals, as proposed, including goal 6 on water, will be adopted at the summit in September this year. And perhaps I should read out the title of goal 6, ensure availability and sustainable management of water and sanitation for all. There are 6 sub-goals, but one of them has 3 sub-goals, so I would argue there are 8 sub-goals. Since you know, it takes too much time, I will not read out these goals, and I'm very sure you must have seen them. If not, you know, I definitely advise you to check, you know, these 8 sub-goals and goal 6. So what I would like to stress, you know, in this conjunction is I'm very happy that, you know, water is getting more and more, you know, attention in the world. And I would also argue it's very natural that, you know, water is becoming a more serious issue for humanity in the course of the 21st century. Therefore, no, it's no, very crucial, first, no, to establish, no, such a goal with 8 sub-goals. It's also very crucial, definitely more important and more crucial to implement, no, these, no, 8 sub-goals. And they are definitely, no, UNESCO's role will become more important, and more particularly, you know, UNESCO's, you know, IHP will have a more important role to play in that, you know, context. But going back to my 10 years, if I may, I would like to also mention that on one hand, I said, you know, UNESCO must establish, you know, strong collaboration with other UN agencies dealing with water, establishing a new framework for such a body under a new initiative, which I said I announced in March 2000, the second water forum. And I also mentioned I was very happy to present the first UN report on water at the third meeting held in Kyoto. And perhaps I should mention that, you know, I made it a rule to attend, you know, the World and Water Forum, which was held every 3 years. So I did go to the Water Forum in 2006, and my last attendance of the World Water Forum was in March 2009, held in Istanbul, Turkey. There again, you know, I was very happy being a Japanese. Japan's crown prince was present. As you know, he is particularly interested in water, so he came to Istanbul to attend the World Water Forum. And in addition, I was able to have lots of private conversations as well. So I once again repeat, you know, these, you know, steps, you know, to strengthen UN-wide collaboration, to strengthen, you know, in a wide approach in a more coordinated way to the fresh water issues. But I must mention once again, coming back to UNESCO, of course, no, IHP must play a crucial role, but that is not enough. That was my judgment, and it's important to be able to mobilize member states and also water experts in member states much more actively, much more widely. And when I arrived at UNESCO, I discovered there were a number of research institutes established and then the guidance of UNESCO or directly by UNESCO, but I analyzed these institutes mostly in the area of education. There are institutes which must be directly managed by UNESCO itself, but there are institutes for which member states where institutes are located must take major responsibility for management. And I proposed to member states the first group of institutes must be called Category 1 institute, therefore directly managed by UNESCO and also directly financed by UNESCO, of course, with additional financial help, in particular from the host countries, but also from other member states. But there must be another group of institutes, which I call Category 2 institute, which must be managed by member governments, but with help from UNESCO. And I propose to my staff, in particular, we should try to encourage member states to establish these institutes in member states. And I was very lucky to receive a proposal from the Dutch government to turn their most institute in the Netherlands to UNESCO to be called Category 1 institute. Nevertheless, Dutch government, host government, will continue to finance almost totally the operation of the institute. Therefore, I was very happy. I accept the proposal, and I chose an American as its first director. And then, after his departure, Sorozinaji went there. Apparently, he now retired. But nevertheless, that institute is the Category 1 institute in the area of water. Accepting a number of students from many countries, but in particular from developing countries, to provide further education, further training to those students in the area of water management. But also, I was very happy that there were a number of proposals to establish a Category 2 institute. Picking up a particular area, and I think you know that the Japanese government proposed to establish a category two institute in Tsukuba, Japan, in the area of water hazard, water disaster. Now it's called ICHAM, and it was headed by Professor Takeuchi, who was a long-time member and very active member of IHP. So I'm very happy now the Japanese government took initiative establishing what is called ICHAM, but also number of other governments. I don't know how many category to institute now exist, but I remember there were two popular areas chosen by member governments to establish category to institute. One of them is water. The other is what now we call intangible cultural heritage. That is also the initiative that I started, you know, in the area of culture, which led to the adoption of a new convention, intangible cultural heritage convention in 2003. But this is something else. I will not elaborate on it. But I repeat, you know, these two areas, water and and intangible cultural heritage, became very popular themes among member states to establish their own institute, research institute or training institute in collaboration with UNESCO. In that way, I once again repeat, in addition to IHP, UNESCO was able to mobilize member states and water experts in many countries to collaborate in particular areas. I mentioned in the context of IJAM, Japan's institute in the area of water hazard, water disaster, how to cope with the water hazard, how to cope with disasters caused by water. In this way, UNESCO itself would be able to enlarge the scope of activities, of course, centering around, IHP, but nevertheless, enlarging their UNESCO activities into other areas. And I must mention that, when I propose to start a new UN-wide initiative, of course, I knew I would need new money, which I could not identify in the normal budget of UNESCO. I asked the Japanese government to give me extra budgetary fundings. And perhaps I should mention, I was dealing with Japan's official development assistance for a number of years. So in a way, I knew how to get money. Of course, Japan's contributions were contributions from other member states. Not necessarily all counted as ODA, but technically, nevertheless, these contributions, voluntary contributions, which would contribute to helping developing countries, are counted as ODA. That is a rule established by OECD's DAC, DAC. Therefore, I took advantage of my background in order to get more help, financial help from the Japanese government, without which, I must confess, I would not have been able to announce UN-wide initiative. Once again, that would cost money. Therefore, I was very happy the Japanese government responded to my plea positively. So while I was there, Japanese government continued to help me. But when I was leaving, Japanese government indicated to me they would not be able to continue after my departure. For one thing, Japan continues to have financial difficulties, as you may know. And Japan has been reducing its ODA budget, which is a very unfortunate development in my judgment. But nevertheless, that is a fact of life. I could not possibly insist that the help, Japan's help to water should continue after my departure. Then, you know, Italy came in. Italy said they would help us. But nevertheless, we had a lot of difficulties with but nevertheless, I don't know how things stand at the moment. But I'm very happy a number of other nations are helping UNESCO in that area. And perhaps I should also mention that it's very unfortunate as I mentioned, you know, United States came back in 2003, finally, and started paying 22% to the UNESCO's budget. And in addition, they started paying, you know, a lot of voluntary contributions. But as you know, as a result of Palestine's joining UNESCO, or as a result of Palestine being accepted by UNESCO as a new member, United States stopped paying its assessed contribution, and of course, you know, it stopped paying voluntary contributions. And quite a few developed countries, you know, which did not stop their assessed contribution, but which, you know, reduced, which started reducing their voluntary contributions. As a result, UNESCO now faces a very serious financial difficulty. So within the reduced budget, within the reduced voluntary contributions, UNESCO is now forced to handle important, crucial issues, including water. So I have a lot of sympathy for UNESCO. I often go to Paris, you know, in other contexts, or sometimes, you know, in the context of UNESCO as well, but I do talk to my predecessor, Madame Bokova, and also many other staff of UNESCO, and I roughly know what difficulties they face now, and I congratulate them nevertheless. In spite of these difficulties, everybody is working very hard to sustain UNESCO's important activities in many areas, and I definitely applaud, you know, those staff who are here from UNESCO, who are dealing with UNESCO in spite of these difficulties. But I cannot, you know, nevertheless, you know, I cannot help express my hope that in spite of these difficulties, UNESCO will continue to play an important role, in particular in the new SDGs period that will start very, very soon. And I once again stress there will be a very important new goal 6 with 8 sub-goals in the area of water. Therefore, IHP's responsibilities will further increase. UNESCO's responsibilities in the area of water will further increase. All I can do at this moment is to express my sincere hope that things will go better in the coming years. Perhaps I should stop here, and I'm prepared to listen to any comments.
Yeah, we'll have some interaction with you, okay. But thank you very much. It's a pleasure to have your lecture, and also recording how you contributed to UNESCO to make UNESCO an important leading organization within the UN water family. Please take a seat over there. We'll have some questions maybe to go.
Okay.
But before that, I have to work this year UNESCO is celebrating the 70th anniversary of UNESCO, and so it is our pleasure to present you this souvenir of the 70th anniversary of UNESCO, the medal of the 70th anniversary.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yes, it's Speaking of the 70th anniversary, I'm certainly invited by another book about to come to UNESCO on November 16th, the day UNESCO's new constitution was adopted in 1945 in London. I'm looking forward to that event as well.
Thank you very much. This is, but you have heard that during Matsuura-san's time, UNESCO's water program, support water programs were born, the World Water Assessment Program, which coordinates the publication on behalf of the entire U.S. system involving more than 20 UN agencies, is established with the initiative of Matsuura-san and with funding of the Japanese government. The world's largest water education institute, UNESCO, in depth has joined UNESCO and has become an integral part of UNESCO. And also during Matsuura-san's time, the UNESCO category 2 centers, on water centers under the auspices of UNESCO, has grown in number. Now we have over 30 centers, water data centers. And also during, I remember when you have presented the second World Water Development Report in Istanbul to the Crown Prince of Japan, because that time I was already with UNESCO, so it was a really big event, and that was the time when UNESCO was in all national and international media. So that was really shows the importance of UNESCO. And I also remember that during your time, we also enjoyed very strong support of the Japanese government, and with your permission, I would like to share with the participants my anecdote. That there was, like, we used to have a regular budget for our activities, but there were sometimes requests from member states to have specific projects on water, and we have to find funding for those projects. And we would go directly to Director General and ask, okay, we need to implement this project, we need funds, and then do we have? Director General would ask, well, do we have funds from the regular program? We said no. And then stop, okay, Japanese fund trust. Japanese fund trust. So everyone was, every project was funded by the Japanese fund trust, directly from the Japanese official development assistance. So it was really an important time for UNESCO to grow as the leading UN agency in the field of water sciences. So with this pleasure, I would like to invite you to have an interactive discussion with Matsuura-san. You can ask questions, even if it's not related to water. Maybe you are involved with the UNESCO activities in your countries, in different fields, education, culture, or if you just would like to have more, to hear more about history of UNESCO water programs. So please feel free, yes, over there. And please introduce yourself and ask a question.
Thank you very much for your very nice talk. I am Duminda Pereira. Actually, I am from ICHA, which Category 2 Center you established maybe 9 years ago. Now, next year we are celebrating the 10th year anniversary of ICHA, I think. So I would like to hear about when you established or you proposed ICHA. It's 10 years back. So do you think that we achieved your goals, like what you had in your mind? And now we are thinking about next 10 years about ICHA. So we really appreciate if you can give your suggestions and comments about ICHA and future. Thank you.
Well, I'm very happy that the category 2 institute in your country is functioning well. And how many category 2 centers are existing?
30.
Over 30?
Yes.
That's amazing.
Half of the all UNESCO water category 2 centers are water.
I'm very happy to hear that. I must confess, nevertheless, I focus on my 10 years at UNESCO from 1999 to 2009. After I left and settled, I occasionally visited UNESCO. But nevertheless, I must confess, I'm not necessarily updated on concrete issues or on the handling of concrete issues, including water and UNESCO. Therefore, I would hesitate should do, what these researchers should do, except to refer back to what I have said, referring to the new SDG goal 6, I said there are 8 sub-goals. These are priority goals for the UN system, but for the entire humanity, and possibly these category of institutions, including this, should focus on the at least on one of these issues or on issues related to these, and also it's important to produce a concrete result. I cannot go further than that, except making concrete suggestions.
Well, actually, ICHAN, the center you now work with, is one of the most active water, contributed to water centers, and it serves as a technical secretariat of the International Flood Initiative, which is a joint UN program led by UNESCO, jointly with WMO and other international organizations, and under the leadership of former director Takeuchi Kuni. Yeah, you maybe you have worked with him, and so it is really nice example of how centers contribute. We have also here one of the newly established Kyoto Center from Egypt. Yeah, so this is the center purely focused on water quality, and that's going to be a regional center on water quality monitoring in that region. So the Kyoto centers are important. An important pillar of implementation of our activities in member states.
Is there anybody from the category 1 institute in the Netherlands?
In the Netherlands, we don't have anyone from that institute, but we have close collaboration with them, and we look forward to strengthen our collaboration with that institute. Yeah. We have also here representatives of our international committees. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you want to have ask a question? Does not even, yeah. So this, yeah, I think it's very interesting to hear about the history, all the history work that has been done to arrive to this point. And I think if UNESCO is very strong today in the field of water science, it's thanks to you. And also I remember, also this required lots of work on our side, Secretary, to catch up with your initiatives. I remember my former director talking about after your announcement in The Hague, in the Second World Water Forum, about the establishment of the World Water Assessment Program and launching of the first water development report, and you had to work so hard to prepare the proposal. And so, of course, and also it was very nice to bring together the UN family, the UN system, working together under the leadership of UNESCO. That is, I think, the most important part of UNESCO, that how we can also not only mobilize the scientific expertise, but also to bring together other UN organizations to work on one particular topic. And you know, it's very difficult to work with all other UN agencies, because every agency has specific mandate and objective, and also to convince our member states executive board on those initiatives and programs. So would you like to have more, to hear more about UNESCO's history, or do you think that you have learned and now you know all about history of UNESCO or water programs? Well, I think now we are about...
Yes. One more thing I should like to mention. At the time, Japanese government seconded very experienced Japanese experts to the water division. And he was there working for the social network, but he also direct access to me, and he worked at UNESCO for 4 or 5 years, and after he came back, he wrote a PhD thesis on water issue at UNESCO. He got a PhD from Tokyo University, and he gave me the thesis. Unfortunately, it's in Japanese. Once again, you know, I was not able to locate that thesis, which I must have in my apartment, but not in the warehouse. I wanted to read it again to refresh my memory when I failed. But he wrote a very good, you know, and
symposium. He will be here tonight and he will join our symposium and he's going to speak tomorrow.
Oh, very good.
Yes. So we
so
will then
you should tell him to.
Yeah, we will then ask a question about authors in his dissertation.
Yeah, I just would like to mention about how the UNESCO growing and throughout his period, because I was working in the different organization UNEP, and the UNEP used to be the reading organization in the modern, but precisely when the Professor Matsuura established the IHP and reinforced the World Mental Health Assessment Program, the UNESCO became a leading organization among all UN organizations. And I attended the World Mental Health Forum 3 and 4 and how big it was. And you will be, you cannot believe how many participants are there. I think that all mobilization is thanks for his power and thanks for his personality. He was working for a long time as ambassador, but not only that, he mobilized. I think that kind of leadership that we should have. He's an extraordinary Japanese from my point of view, and also one of the proudest Japanese among all. And we are very happy to see him as one of the special appointed professors of Kyoto University. We are very happy to be here with him and with all of your participants. And I think we should terminate today with a special session with Prof. Thank you very much.